Each and every one of us can think of at least one decision that we've made in our lives that causes us to say, well, I don't know what I was thinking. It seemed to me like a good idea at the time. I just had to make a decision. But I have never seen anybody with a track record quite like President Obama's. It is amazing to me because his mistakes aren't the exception, they are the rule. But as I started to line this out last night for you, there is something more to his mistakes. His mistakes almost always do harm. What is the Hippocratic Oath? The Hippocratic Oath for doctors is first do no harm. What it means is a doctor can try to help you, but he can't harm you. He can't make things worse. In trying to treat you, he can't do that. First, do no harm. The president's Hippocratic Oath has been violated to the point where the patient is now in critical condition, and we've got the doctor putting a screwdriver in the patient's eye. I don't even understand it. Last night, I touched on this, and I want to go over this again with you, because I think any reasonable person, any of your neighbors that are not blinded by party loyalty, but somebody who says, look, I want to give Obama a fair shake, and, you know, I don't like the Republicans, I don't like the Democrats, whatever, but I want to be fair. I think they can look at this list and, at least in retrospect, see how wrong the president's choices have been made. But more than just wrong, these are dangerous choices, and they cannot be allowed to be continued. This is the case I want you to make with your friends. I want you to ask them how he is on foreign policy. How's he doing? They'll say, I don't know, you know, things are a little upset. Okay, good. Let's just look at some of the things that he's done. Because I believe that he has been on the wrong side of virtually every single issue. Now, this is not political. First, do no harm. When he rushes in to help, to offer aid, he harms. And it's not just that he's wrong, he harms. When he says it's time to wait for the facts, I've got to get some more data in here, he's wrong because it harms the nation. I need you to make this case with your friends. You and I have seen enough to make an educated decision, and you need to show your friends who are gettable yet. Because I really truly believe any sane person that just engages in common sense, in quiet, thoughtful tones, don't bash Obama or the Democrats or anybody else. There's no reason to anymore. Just show them the facts and ask them some questions. Ask them, I'm going to show you these things, and I want you to, what does your gut tell you? And the decision that was made, does it divide? Does it degrade? Does it destroy? Or does it lift up? Does it inspire? Does it create? Which on the surface does it do? Which philosophy did it end up helping? Did it help freedom and American principles? Or did it help something else that is against America? I mean, you start with the basic question, is he right or wrong? Was he right or wrong on this? Start here. One of the first things that President Obama did that I just scratched my head, it was one of the first press conference. He was asked a question, he said, you know, I don't have a lot of facts. I have a friend in Boston, and he was arrested, and the cops acted stupidly, remember?
I should say at the outset that Skip Gates is a friend, so I may be a little biased here. I don't know, not having been there and not seeing all the facts, what role race played in that, but I think it's fair to say, number one, any of us would be pretty angry. Number two, that the Cambridge police acted stupidly.
As it turns out, the guy who he's saying acted stupidly was one of the leading officers on race relations. He's one of the best that they have. Now, here's what you ask your friends. Is this more evidence, with what you knew then, was this more evidence of cops targeting minorities? Or do you think that the police were just doing their job? And by assuming that the cops acted stupidly, does he help mend race relations or stoke the flames? Does maligning the police without the facts line up more with Occupy Wall Street or common sense? In the end, was he right? No, he wasn't. That's why there was no lesson and he had to have the guy over for a beer, because he had to kind of just make this go away. Let's go to the Black Panthers. You remember the voter intimidation case? A clear wrong. But the Obama administration stepped in and dropped the case. When they asked why they let the Black Panthers off the hook, Holder said, because focusing on the Black Panthers, quote, demeans my people.
To compare what people were subjected to there to what happened in Philadelphia, which is inappropriate, certainly that, but to call that, to put it, describe it in those terms, I think does a great disservice to people who put their lives on the line, who risked all for my people.
Who are his people? I've never referred to white people as my people. Have you? What does your gut say about the Black Panther thing? Should these guys go to jail? Was justice served or sacrificed? Did freeing the Black Panthers for no apparent reason, did it help unite Americans or divide them? Did it empower a group like the Black Panthers or did it empower justice? Was Obama right to let him walk? We could do this all night. Egypt in the Arab Spring. When the Arab Spring broke out, because a person lit themselves on fire and ended up dying from those wounds, and revolutions were started, and deadly clashes broke out with police everywhere, what did your gut say? This is going to be a good thing for America or a bad thing? Were you hesitant? Or did you say, let's go in and help them? Well, here's what Obama said.
For 18 days, the eyes of the world were glued to Tahrir Square, where Egyptians from all walks of life, men and women, young and old, Muslim and Christian, demanded their universal rights. We saw in those protesters the moral force of nonviolence that has lit the world from Delhi to Warsaw, from Selma to South Africa. And we knew that change had come to Egypt and to the Arab world.
I think to compare the Arab Spring to Selma, Alabama, might demean Eric Holder's people just a little bit. It's absurd to compare what happened in the Arab Spring with Martin Luther King. The moral force of nonviolence, first of all, I think Lyra Logan would disagree with that assessment strongly. But he also said, this is how the international community is supposed to work. It is, with violence, with chaos, out on the streets, revolution. That's what we're supposed to be encouraging? Was the president right or wrong? In the end, are the people better off? Did his words help heal the Middle East or unite it or set it on fire? Did it help American ideas and principles? Or did it help the Muslim Brotherhood? Which did it do? The Muslim Brotherhood. Almost as soon as Mubarak was running for his life, Obama began lending credibility to the Muslim Brotherhood, going so far as to call them a secular organization. Remember?
The term Muslim Brotherhood is an umbrella term for a variety of movements. In the case of Egypt, a very heterogeneous group, largely secular, which has eschewed violence and has decried Al-Qaeda as a perversion of Islam.
How is it possible that the Muslim Brotherhood is non-secular? That's like saying the Catholic League is non-secular. You only need a heartbeat to know that the Muslim Brotherhood is about Islam. The Muslim Brotherhood member and new president of Egypt is trying to get a terrorist, the blind sheikh now, the guy responsible for the World Trade Center attacks, the first one, out of prison. The Obama administration defends holding meetings with those people at the White House. Here they are.
Our policy is clear and is the same, which is that in the aftermath of Egypt's revolution, we have broadened our engagement to include new and emerging political parties and actors. Because it's a fact that Egypt's political landscape has changed and the actors have become more diverse, and our engagement reflects that. The point is that we will judge Egypt's political actors by how they act, not by their religious affiliation.
What a red herring. They made a special visa exemption in order to meet with the Brotherhood members, even the ones belonging to U.S.-designated terror groups. Terrorists were given an exemption to go meet at the White House. Yet, at the same time, they would make a special case, an exemption, for terrorists to come into the White House, the Muslim Brotherhood. Obama declined to meet with Benjamin Netanyahu because he was busy with David Letterman. Ask your neighbors, what does your gut say about that? Muslim Brotherhood, they suspended the laws to let the terrorists come in and met, but they wouldn't meet with Benjamin Netanyahu. Is there any hesitation with cozying up to radical groups like the Brotherhood? By the way, it's not just me who believes the Muslim Brotherhood is evil. There's a story out today reporting that the rulers of several major Arab nations are now accusing the Brotherhood of having ambitions, think about this one, to seize power illegitimately and claim the radical group is the source of all problems in the Islamic world. No. I don't know if you know this story. Last night, after I got off the air, we found out that we are now rushing troops into Jordan, a country that is currently experiencing turmoil. Okay, why? Because the Muslim Brotherhood just pressured the president of Syria, or of Jordan, to dismantle the government or else face massive Muslim Brotherhood-led protests. They obliged. Now we're sending troops into Jordan. Are we going to help the king who's a friend of ours, or are we helping the Muslim Brotherhood? Does it feel right to you that we're sending troops into Jordan? Have you heard the case being made by anyone? Why are we in Libya? Well, we're in Libya, we were told, because we have Samantha Powers, Cass Sunstein's wife, the responsibility to protect. This is something that George Soros funded, got through the entire world. Should we be in Libya? Was that the right call? What did your gut say when you saw this? Hillary Clinton laughing and bragging about assassinating Muammar Gaddafi.
As we came, we saw, he died.
Did it have anything to do with...
Is this the way that we behave in America now? Especially, we're laughing when he's being dragged through the streets. I mean, this guy was a brutal murderer. But this is French Revolution, not American Revolution. And is Libya better off now? When it comes to the Middle East and the Arab Spring and Libya and all of this stuff, whom have our actions empowered? The guys like us, the guys who like America, the guys who want to live in freedom, or the guys who despise America? By the way, we had yet another embassy worker killed in Yemen this morning. The Benghazi attack. The president comes out right away and says, this is because of a YouTube film. Remember?
The unrest we've seen around the region has been in reaction to a video.
What sparked the recent violence was the airing on the internet of a very hateful, very offensive video.
Over an awful internet video that we had nothing to do with.
It was a crude and disgusting video. Sparked outrage throughout the Muslim world.
This is so incredible because this furthers a Muslim Brotherhood agenda item, and that is you cannot mock Islam or Muhammad. Now, the Benghazi attacks happened on 9/11. You and I didn't need any facts to understand this was planned. It's not a coincidence that it happened on 9/11. The State Department confirmed that Obama was wrong. They knew that night, and yet they went on. Why? Was it just another bad decision? Because I've got more bad decisions. Trayvon Martin. The police investigation was barely even underway when the president did something I've never seen the president of the United States ever do in a local case. He decides to throw his hat into the ring and make this a giant national story, not to calm things down, but to stoke the fires. Remember?
I can only imagine what these parents are going through. And when I think about this boy, I think about my own kids. You know, if I had a son, he'd look like Trayvon.
It was quite a time and quite a statement to make when you didn't have any facts. Police acted stupidly. Solyndra. Obama rushed and pressured budget analysts to review the Solyndra loan in time for an announcement by Joe Biden in September 2009. The Energy Department said the project would go bankrupt by September 2011. Bush had already rejected this deal, but Obama puts this thing back on. Now, what does your gut say? Is it a wise decision to dump money into something that every analyst said we shouldn't do? Was it a wise decision? Or was it driven by politics or, God forbid, something worse? Because was he right on that decision, pressuring everybody, make the loan, make the loan, make the loan? Did it help America or hurt it? Occupy Wall Street is another one where he rushed in to help, to lend his support. He didn't hesitate to throw his support behind Occupy Wall Street right off the bat.
I understand the frustrations that are being expressed in those protests. In some ways, they're not that different from some of the protests that we saw coming from the Tea Party.
It's interesting that he did that because he never said good things about the Tea Party. He said that we were violent and everything else. And yet, this isn't. I mean, was he right to praise them? With all the violence, the filth, the drugs, the criminal acts, trying to blow up bridges in Ohio, the multiple rapes and sexual assaults. What does your gut say about this image? Keep in mind that Occupy leaders encourage rape victims to keep silent. Yet, keep in mind that this White House says it is conservatives who have a war on women. Did the Occupy Wall Street movement that the president said is good, did it lift up? Did it create? Did it inspire? Or was it its intent to tear down and divide and to destroy? Was the president right? Was he on the right side? Are they the same? Is this the same as the Tea Party? Instead of rushing to support the Tea Party, like he did with Occupy Wall Street, at first he ignored them, and then later he demeaned them.
You know, those of you who are watching certain news channels that, you know, on which I'm not very popular, and you see folks waving tea bags around.
He told his supporters to get into their face.
I need you to go out and talk to your friends and talk to your neighbors. I want you to talk to them whether they're independent or whether they are Republican. I want you to argue with them and get in their face. And
I don't ever want you to argue with somebody or get into somebody's face. I've told you for a long time, let them be. Move on. Why would gut check? Gut check. Is that how the American president should tell people, I want you to argue with people. I want you to get into their face. Does that uplift, inspire? Does it unite? Or does that tear down, vilify, and destroy? Gut check on Fort Hood. When this happened, every American was waiting for the president to speak. He waited several hours. We waited for anyone to respond to this. And when he finally did, it was bizarre because he gave a shout out in the rally. He was in rally mode for a long time. He spent several minutes before even addressing the tragic shooting.
I want to thank my cabinet members and senior administration officials who participated today. I hear that Dr. Joe Medicine Crow was around, and so I want to give a shout out to that Congressional Medal of Honor winner.
Good to see you.
That was his priority over Fort Hood. And when he finally did address it, he didn't call it a terrorist attack. It was later called a workplace shooting, gut check. The Fort Hood shooter was a radicalized Muslim who killed troops while yelling Allah Akbar. He hated American occupiers. Is that a workplace incident? Was Obama right? What does your friend, your neighbor's gut say? By ignoring the real cause and seemingly not paying much respect to the victims, did Obama unite or divide Americans with his words? Who is he empowering? You and the American way? Truth, justice, and the American way? Or something else? Christmas time, the Times Square bomber. Remember this? He waited. He waited before he said anything. The Iranian uprising. He never said anything. The people needed the president's voice, and he never said anything. Osama bin Laden, a terrorist who killed over 3,000 innocent Americans. Obama had to sleep on it and considers it, quote, a gutsy call to say, yeah, let's kill Osama bin Laden. What? The BP oil spill. In the first 50 days while the spill was gushing oil into the Gulf, he hosted concerts at the White House, Kelly Clarkson and Paul McCartney. And then he put a moratorium on offshore drilling. Was that the right decision? Waiting to investigate Benghazi, he vowed to find the killers and bring them to justice weeks after the event. But FBI agents weren't allowed to investigate the scene for weeks after the event. Family of lost loved ones were told outright lies or nothing at all. And when the FBI was finally allowed on site last week, they were only there for 3 hours and then left. Was he right or wrong? Who has he empowered by not investigating? The good guys or the bad guys? I don't think you need to do much convincing. These facts, unlike Obama's, are not evolving. They speak for themselves. Obama is wrong on almost every single critical issue. We can't afford another 4 years. We have to chart a new course, not an old one, not a Bush course, a new one, and restore America to her critical place in the world, the place that the rest of the world is waiting for us to square our shoulders and stand back up and say, okay, guys, we have it, the place where the rest of the world looks for hope.